Good morning, everybody. We can start with today's session. The first session is Christian Greisinger from Göttingen, and he's going to tell us about protein dynamics inside from NMR.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. When I submitted something, can you hear me? There's an abstract in the book of abstracts. But actually, I thought this was for one lecture. Then I found out when I arrived here that I have two lectures, and that's why I split it now in two. One is more on globular proteins, and this will be this I will discuss today. And then on the last lecture, which I think is a Friday afternoon, I will talk about intrinsically disordered proteins. And Claudio will talk about this also today. So I think it's more appropriate then also to have this tomorrow. And Ruth Nussinoch was yesterday discussing a lot protein-protein interaction and recognition of interfaces and so on, and discussing there in principle also the promiscuity of proteins in recognizing different binding partners and how they do that and so on. And actually, this will be the major part of this talk. I mean, we are working since all together now, I think 14 years or so, on a specific protein, ubiquitin, which was also mentioned by Ruth yesterday. And I will tell you a little bit, maybe in too much detail, but I hope you will stay concentrated on what we think could be actually a more general way of how proteins behave and react. And this is actually done with several methods. They are mainly NMR spectroscopy, and that's why also I will introduce a little bit NMR to you. I'm working at this institute here. You see it's lying a little bit on a hill close to a little part of the city, Nikolausberg in Göttingen. That's the city where I'm working, and this is the NMR department. We have quite a few NMR spectrometers. I took out the picture, but I will show it tomorrow. From which we then derive our insights from NMR. Now, since NMR spectroscopy was not really introduced at this conference yet, I thought I'd bring a little bit of a very basic introduction to NMR spectroscopy, and those who are still digesting the pork cow meat may fall asleep, and then I start talking louder again when it becomes more interesting. But those who may be not so familiar with NMR, it's very basic. What are we interested in NMR spectroscopy is, of course, into the structure as well as the dynamics of molecules. There are other applications of magnetic resonance. For example, magnetic resonance imaging is something which is also used, but here for the spectroscopy, it's really these very tiny objects that we are interested in. And of course, the molecules are built from atoms, and atoms have nuclei. Here are the atoms, and for example, here, one of the PET atom actually that we are looking at with NMR spectroscopy is the proton. The proton here you see it's maybe the pre-Bohr picture of an atom. It has a nucleus, and here you see the tiny electron circling around, and this nucleus actually is what we are looking at in nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. Many of the nuclei actually have a spin, which is this eigennotation of the magnetic moment of the nucleus, and this creates then a magnetic moment similar to the electron. And in NMR we use the nucleus. In EPR, electron power magnetic resonance, people are using the fact that the electrons have also a spin. Now, for the electrons, they also always, most of the time, you have just a single electron, therefore you have spin 1/2. In the case of the atoms or the nuclei, there are various spins. Some of the spins are zero, for example, for carbon-12. Unfortunately, it spins zero, and then it doesn't have a magnetic moment. But for the proton, for carbon-13, which is a natural isotope, non-radioactive, can be introduced into molecules. It's also spin 1/2. Also for N15, which is also a natural isotope, natural abundance is about 0.4% or so, can be brought into molecules also, has also spin 1/2. While carbon-12, unfortunately, is spin zero, and nitrogen-14, the most abundant isotope for the nitrogens has spin 1 and therefore cannot be used so nicely in NMR spectroscopy. Now, of course, since we have a magnetic moment, we can depict it as a magnetic needle, which, if we have an external magnetic field, B0, will orient in this field. And since we have spin 1/2, we have only two states, the spin up and down state. This one is the favored one, in which the magnetic moment goes along with the B0 field, and the disfavored one, the other one, is the one in which it's opposing, and so there's an energy difference between the two, which can then be used. Now, since Anderson and Ernst in 1966, NMR spectroscopy is done not in a CW way, not in a way, for example, like a UV spectrum or an IR spectrum, unless it's FTIR is taken, namely by just going through with the frequency, scanning through, and then seeing where there's an absorption. But Anderson and Ernst invented the pulse Fourier principle in 1966. And this is depicted here. One applies a radio frequency pulse onto the magnetization, which is created from the fact that the more favorable state is the aligned state, the disfavored state is the opposite state. So we have a macroscopic magnetization from a sample, and this macroscopic magnetization is shown here in red, which aligns with the B0 field, which is going along the z-axis here. And then with the radio frequency pulse, one can put it into the y direction, for example, here, and then it starts precessing. And this precession actually is recorded as a so-called free induction decay. There's an x component of the free induction decay, and there's a y component of the free induction decay, and this is recorded in time. The z component is just drawn here as a projection to this axis. It's not recorded because there's no frequency. The recording of the magnetization goes with the Faraday induction principle, and the sensitivity goes proportional with the frequency. And therefore, here the frequency would be zero. Here the frequency would be the frequency of for example, 600 megahertz if we have a sufficiently high field, or now there are commercially available fields up to 1 gigahertz, and we have frequencies here of this recording in the gigahertz range, and therefore then the sensitivity of the recording is high. Now, this is not yet a spectrum. It's just the free induction decay of a single magnetization. And so the next thing what one has to do then is to Fourier transform. And to transform the time signal into a frequency signal, and what then comes out from such a decaying oscillatory behavior here would be a single line located at a certain frequency and with a certain width. And this Fourier transformation, just for completeness of the information here, was invented by Jean-Baptiste Joseph Fourier in these 3 years here. He was actually, this was, as you may see from the years here, this was during the French Revolution. And actually he was a governor in the department Rhône-Alpes. Whoever was there is probably, it's mainly known for skiing. At the time, people were not so much interested in skiing, so it was a pretty remote place, and this is probably also what saved his head, because at the time, the intellectuals were very likely to be beheaded, and so he could work in silence and so on probably during this time, just because he was in this very remote place. So the Fourier transformation then gives the signal here, and it's very similar to
to hearing, of course. I mean, for example, when I talk to you here, you hear me in a low voice or in a high voice, and this, of course, is done in the ear immediately. So everybody, when listening to me, is doing a Fourier transformation on the flight. Your inner ear is nothing else than a Fourier transformator, so it's a very natural a way of looking at time domain signals. Okay, now, so far I was just mentioning one signal or one frequency, but of course if we have molecules which contain different nuclei, for example, like here in ethanol, which I like very much in the form of caipirinha here in Rio, then of course we have three different proton groups. For example, here the proton attached to the oxygen, the two protons attached to the methylene group here, and the methyl protons, and they have different chemical environments. The chemical environments is clear. I mean, an oxygen is different from a carbon, is different from a methyl carbon, and therefore the chemical shifts, which means that the frequencies at which these different protons resonate, they are different. And this chemical resolution is actually the reason why NMR spectroscopy has become so important in chemistry and especially also in biology, because this differentiation of identical nuclei due to the fact that they have different chemical environments due to the chemical structure of the molecule is what we are what one can use in principle for atomic resolution, for resolution which I will show you, which is goes below angstrom resolution. So it's similar to the resolution that X-ray crystallography can obtain. And similarly to the simple spectrum of ethanol, in which you have just three proton resonances, we can also see this in biomolecules. For example, here a biomolecule carmodulin together with a peptide has probably something like 1,000 of these protons, but the makeup of the spectrum is exactly the same. We have just more resonances here, but they are distributed in the spectrum here in a very restricted range of frequencies, which is written down here in ppm. Ppm would be then just parts per million of the resonance frequency. And for example, for a 600 megahertz spectrometer, these 10 ppm, which are covered here, would be about 6 kilohertz. Yeah? So it's a very restricted frequency range, and therefore the overlap between the different resonances becomes apparent immediately. For example, here you see these little peaks. These are individual protons in the molecule, but then you see there are other regions in the spectrum, for example, here the aromatic as well as the amide region, where there's a lot of overlap just because it happens that different protons resonate more or less at the same frequency, and therefore you get these big humps of signals. Similarly, here in the aliphatic region, or here in the in the C-alpha region, or then also here in the aliphatic regions, CH2 groups, CH3 groups, and so on, there's a lot of overlap happening here. Now, the thing is, of course, how then to extract this information? And the information has to be extracted such that we can assign the different resonances to the different nuclei in our chemical formula, because otherwise we will not be able to extract properties of these resonances and learn something about the molecule or different parts in the molecule. And it's a similar question to who of the two here is the dumb one and who is the fat one. Now, both look a little bit dumb, but this certainly is the more fatter guy than this one here. And so here the assignment is pretty easy. Also here for the ethanol assignment, the assignment is very easy because, as you can see here, we have a signal which is much taller than this signal here, and this is a little bit taller but also broader, appreciably more broad than this one here. And so one will say, okay, let's assume that the number of protons is reflected in the integral of the respective signal, and then, of course, we can see that this will be the methyl group, this will be the methylene group, and this is OH because this is 1 and 2 and 3 protons. But this very simple assignment of the resonances does not work in all cases, especially not if you have, for example, such a protein here, this case here, lysozyme with 130 amino acids. We know, of course, the general construction principle of the protein is from amino acids. Each amino acid is repetitive in its backbone. We have an amide, we have a C-alpha to which a side chain is attached, and then we have the carbonyl group and then so on. And the only differentiation is in the side chains, but we somehow need to find out how they are connected to each other. Normally, when one enters such an investigation, one knows the sequence beforehand. So NMR spectroscopy is not normally used. Of course, it can do it, but it's not normally used to establish the sequence. This is also due to the fact that most of the samples actually are made by E. coli, where you bring in a vector the respective DNA, and then, of course, you know how it is translated into the protein sequence. And it has been mainly Richard Ernst who has contributed to going from one-dimensional spectroscopy to two-dimensional spectroscopy, and then also further or higher dimensions were brought into the play. Here it goes up to three dimensions, but these days, I mean, even seven-dimensional spectra are recorded in order to alleviate this situation. And in principle, what is done is that one connects the nuclei with each other due to the fact that they have couplings. For example, here, if we have an amide moiety, then there is a coupling which goes through the bonds between the proton and the nitrogen with a size of about 93 hertz. And this coupling can be used in order to connect information of the chemical shift of this proton here with the information of the chemical shift of this nitrogen here. So such that in a two-dimensional representation, then one has a peak, which shows up in the spectrum at the frequency of the nitrogen in one dimension and at the frequency of the proton in another dimension. Here you see this two-dimensional plot. So in one dimension, for example, we have protons. In the other dimension, we have nitrogens. And then we can connect these resonance frequencies in this fashion. And the basis for this is the scalar coupling, which is used in liquid state NMR spectroscopy. So when the samples are dissolved in water, for example, when they are tumbling fast, and in solid state, in principle, very similar procedures are used these days. The couplings are larger. They are through the space. They are dipolar couplings, which are averaged out in solution, but they are there in the solid state. And here you see that this coupling, for example, is about 100 times larger than the coupling through the bond. Here we also see 15 hertz, for example, between these two, while it is 1.28 kilohertz between if we go through the dipolar coupling. And I will tell a little bit more about solid state NMR spectroscopy in the second lecture tomorrow. In any case, what one sees is if we have, for example, N15 here, if we have carbon-13 here and also carbon-13 here, then we see there's a network of such couplings which connects the different nuclei with each other, and this then can be used in order to make these correlations, two-dimensional correlation. For example, we can correlate two nuclei with each other. In three-dimensional correlations, we can make we can correlate three nuclei with each other, for example, a proton with a nitrogen and then a C-alpha. So we get this connectivity information by using the scalar couplings that exist. And the most famous way of then assigning proteins, this works up to about 250 amino acids, at concentrations these days of about 0.5 to 1 millimolar. Maybe one can go down to 0.3 millimolar these days in about 300 microliters. The method used since about 1990. This way here, one records in principle two spectra, a CBCA-NH experiment and a CBCA-CONH experiment. Here one sees that one correlates actually four nuclei with each other. It's a three-dimensional experiment. One excites the carbon and also this carbon here. So one has, in principle, in one dimension, one has two nuclei. And then one goes from the carbon to the nitrogen and then to the proton where the detection takes place. This would be one experiment. And then there's the other experiment, the CBCACON agent, which one goes from the C beta to the C alpha, then via the carbonyl to the nitrogen and to the proton.
And one can direct, actually, the flow of magnetization within the molecule putting together the right order, in the right order, the radio frequency pulses. This would be too detailed to explain it to you here now, and probably some of you know anyway how this works. In any case, phenomenologically, what one gets is then these correlations, and that can then be used actually in these three-dimensional experiments. And I'll just show it to you here. For example, if we had such a chain of amino acids here, we can start, for example, here. We look at the NH. So here we have the proton nitrogen. We take a certain slice in the nitrogen dimension, and we have a certain proton frequency here, and then we see a C alpha and a C beta. And then we go just for the same proton nitrogen slice in the spectrum, and then we see another. In addition to the C alpha and the C beta that came from the previous slice, we also see two new ones, and this would be then other alphas and betas. And then actually in the next step, we take those alphas, betas, and alphas, and the laser pointer is going weak a little bit. If there's another one, that would be helpful. So here we correlate now the C beta and the C alpha, and now, of course, we are on the next NH. And then we go further. We take again the same NH and find now here from the C alpha and the C beta, we find two new ones and so on. So we can actually go through the whole thing and just get the assignment of all these resonances. Now, this means that we have a chain in which we connect, like in German it's called Schnitzeljagd. I don't know what it is in English. So I mean there are little letters or little sheets of paper. No, it's just weak. When I press longer, then it's becoming weak. That's clear. So you put little sheets of paper on a tree, and then it gives you directions to the next one, and so on. So you also make a connectivity run if you want. I'm sure that there's an English version for that as well, which probably the Boy Scouts are using all the time. I don't know, but it's a little bit like this, that you are walking through the territory by giving some by using information that you get successively out of the spectrum. So this assignment procedure then is the basis to know which resonance is which, and then you can use various parameters, for example here the NOE, J couplings, other parameters, RDCs, cross-correlated relaxation, chemical shift, in order to transform this into a structure. And this actually was the work mainly by Kurt Wüthrich, who won the Nobel Prize for this in 2002. And how this goes is shown here. So for example, in an OSI, we measure distances between two protons, and this measurement of the distance actually is reflected here in the integral of these peaks. You can nicely see that some of the peaks are very well resolved here, but many other peaks are not resolved, especially in this region here. And this, again, is this, the overlap problem, which you saw in the one-dimensional spectra, which you also see now in the two-dimensional spectra. But if one then goes to higher dimensionality, then one sees that in this region here, from which a slice is taken now out from the respective three-dimensional spectrum in which one correlates together with another carbon. So there's a carbon involved here, which is where one has a slice here. Then one sees all these resonances here, very nicely resolved. And each of them has an index such that we know now, for example, in this case, that valine 56 H gamma is closer than about 5 angstroms to aspartate 53 H beta. Yeah, so we get these non-sequential, from 56 to 53 would be non-sequential correlations, or here, for example, S88 H alpha V56. From 56 to 88, we get these non-sequential proton-proton distances, which are then finally used in order to create a structure. And
these informations actually between the proton-proton distances, actually this should be a J, can be translated into little rubber bands which are spent between the two protons, and then this can be used, of course, for together with molecular dynamics in order to derive a structure. And this would be just a movie where you go from an extended chain, and then using these restraints, this folds up, and then we have the molecular structure here derived from these measurements of NOEs, and as I mentioned, there are other parameters we can measure. And with this, one can actually determine structures of small molecules, for example, here of ubiquitin, and I will show you in the remainder of the lecture how we can say that the molecule is not in a single conformation, like X-ray crystallography always tends to promote this picture that there's just a single conformation, but that actually the structure is very dynamic. But one can also not only look at globular proteins, but also at membrane proteins. Here, for example, this is a protein called VDAC, voltage-dependent anion channel. It's very prominent in your outer mitochondrial membrane. It's a protein through which your weight of ATP and ADP is transported through between the cytosol and the mitochondria each day. So I was also surprised when I read for the first time that 75 kilograms of ATP and ADP is transported between the cytosol and the mitochondria in every person every day. Probably for a sportsman or so who is like, what was his first name, Phelps or so, who is using 8,000 calories per day or so, probably it's then a little bit more. But when you are just sitting here listening to my lecture or so, then probably like something, now I'm bad in calculating, but maybe it's something like 5 kilograms of ATP and ADP have been transported through this little hole here. And that's why it's pretty abundant, actually. In potatoes, for example, it covers 30% of the membrane of the mitochondrial outer membrane, so you see it almost with your eye. One can look at interactions of small molecules when they bind proteins, and this of course is interesting for pharmaceutical investigations. And one can also look at larger structural assemblies. Actually, NMR spectroscopy is very good in hyphenating or hybridizing with other methodologies. This here is a type 3 secretion needle structure, which has been done in a combination between solid-state NMR spectroscopy for local interactions, for example, proton-proton distances between within the monomeric as well as then intermolecular contacts, together with modeling, with Rosetta modeling, and together with electron microscopy, in order to know the general size of the of these needles. And these needles actually are involved in all nice bacterial infections that you can think of. For example, if one eats a bad egg or so and has salmonella, then the virulence factors are actually injected into the host cell, which means into your cells, by these needles. Also, when people get pest and cholera and so on, and all these bacteria actually use these needles in order to inject the virulence factors into the host cells. Okay, now I come to the main topic of the talk, which is some information about the dynamics of ubiquitin. And ubiquitin is a protein that's very ubiquitous. I mean, it's a protein that is attached for protein degradation, but it's also used for trafficking, depending a little bit on where the connection is made. There's the lysine 63. I think if this is used, then it goes to the proteasome and will be digested. If it goes to lysine 46, I think it goes to the ER and so on. So there are various channels through which ubiquitin tags. In principle, it's nothing else than an address of a protein that is is used by this ubiquitin. But we are more interested in the dynamics, and actually NMR spectroscopy is good in looking at dynamics over all these different timescales, from picoseconds actually to seconds. There are methods for all these time ranges. For example, for very fast motion, there's the possibility of looking at relaxation. For then this intermediate range, there were no technologies available, but so-called dipolar couplings, which I will introduce in a second, can be used actually for all these time ranges, and therefore also for this one here. Then there is so-called relaxation dispersion. It's a method which I will also explain when I come to this, which covers this region here between about 50 microseconds and about 10 milliseconds. Then there is exchange spectroscopy, another type of two-dimensional NMR spectroscopy in this millisecond to second time range. And then if processes become slower, if they are happening on several seconds to hours or even months or years or so, then real-time NMR spectroscopy can be used, real-time NMR meaning that one just observes repetitively. You put the sample in, then you look at the spectrum, and then you take it out, and then you look at again maybe a week later or so, and then the sample has changed somehow, and so this will be then the real-time NMR. And here the restriction is only normally the time that a PhD would take or something like that. Slower processes can normally not be really very well observed. Now, we were very much interested in this time range here. I mean, this time range can be looked at, and every protein has it actually. It has motion on the picosecond timescale. This is little wobbling motion and so on that is taking place in every protein. But we were interested in this time range because it's very difficult to explore, and I show you a little bit the results that we have from this one here. Now, in principle, it is the question of what is the experimental basis? And I mean, being an experimentalist, of course, we always have to ask this question. What is the experimental basis of what the MD people, of course, do? Yeah, I mean, you can sit on the computer, you take a structure of a molecule, you put it into any MD program, and this is what you get. But is it real? Is it really happening, or is it just a fantasy of these guys? Yeah, is it just a fantasy of a field? Is it? Yeah, I mean, so we as the experimentalists, I think we have to do the reality check. Yeah, so we have to see, I mean, is it true? Does the molecule really move like this? And on which timescales and so on? Because, I mean, if you have a force field, then, of course, it's in principle an easy task to find out, I mean, which structures are possible. But with respect to the kinetics, it's even more complicated because there you need to know what are the barriers between the different conformations. And I mean, that I think, I guess you will agree, is probably even more error prone. And therefore, I think it's necessary to look at these things. Now, whole fields are doing actually to measure such dynamics is to measure so-called order parameters. The order parameter is a very general concept. For example, if you have a vector which goes here, for example, an amide vector which sits in a protein, then with the order parameter we can measure how mobile this vector is. And there are various possibilities. For example, one is that the order parameter is 1. This would be the extreme value, s equals 1. The vector would be very immobile, very rigid, order parameter 1. However, if the vector is moving around, and this is not actually a kinetic information, not at all, it's just a distribution of orientations with respect to the, maybe for example, the tensor of inertia of the whole molecule. So how does this vector here move with respect to the rest of the molecule? So if it moves here, for example, on a cone with an opening angle of the magic angle, then the order parameter would be 0. The same result would be obtained if it moves with equal probability on the half sphere or even on the whole sphere, then the order parameter would be also 0. If it moves up to this cone here, then the order parameter would be somewhere between 1 and zero. So the measurement of the order parameter actually allows you to tell, I mean, how are the orientations distributed, how mobile is such a vector here. And this can be measured with, if one measures the orientation of such a vector here, and one possibility of measuring this is with so-called dipolar couplings. Dipolar couplings is the coupling between two magnetic moments. It's also like, for example, the interaction between a magnetic needle and the external magnetic field, for example, that the Earth is producing. This also goes via the dipolar coupling, meaning that it's this through space a coupling. One can cast it into this formula here. The dipolar coupling actually is given as the orientation. So these would be the spherical harmonics, y to 0, or and there's also a y to 2 and a y to minus 2 dependence of the coupling. And actually, what are the angles coming from? Well, the angles are coming from the orientation of this vector here with respect to the so-called alignment tensor. And the alignment tensor is shown here. It's attached to the molecule, to the molecule which is shown here. And the alignment tensor is actually induced by putting the molecule into a so-called alignment medium. The alignment medium, for example, could be so-called bicells. It's a mixture from different lipids which form most of the time spherical plates or so, which are kind of swimming in solution. But they do something like this. I mean, if one of these plates is one hand and the other plate is the other hand, then and the B0 field goes in this direction, then they will orient like this. So in principle, we introduce into our sample, we introduce walls, and the difference, the distance between these walls is on the order of about 500 nanometers or something like that. And then one can do the following. I'm moving here now, so one wall is this one here, the other wall is this one here, maybe better this one here. And now let's assume we have a molecule which is looking like my fist. My fist is not isotropic, it's not a sphere, but it's anisotropic. And most of the time, all the molecules have a certain anisotropic shape, maybe also charge distribution and so on. And now, if my molecule is oriented in this direction here, and I have a wall here and a wall here, then the probability that it can be in this orientation here is given just by the number, or is given actually by the distance that it goes from here to here. The center of this molecule goes from here to here. And because it is longer, my fist is longer than it is broad, I have more distances here if I travel from this wall to this wall here than if I'm in this orientation. So here I have less possibilities. The a priori probability is less if I'm in this orientation as compared if I'm in this orientation. And this means that the probability that the molecule is found in this orientation is lower than in this orientation. And that reintroduces the residual dipolar couplings. And that introduces this alignment tensor, which is nothing else than a probability distribution for a certain orientation, namely for this orientation of the molecule here, as compared to, for example, if I turn it around by 90 degrees. And so this alignment can then be used in order to reintroduce these so-called dipolar couplings. Now, the dipolar couplings, as is shown from, or is obvious from this formula here, they are orientation dependent. Because y2-0, for example, who knows what is y2-0? No, I don't accept your answer. Who knows what is y2-0? What did you study? And how many chemists? How many biologists?
Oh, there's a majority. Okay.
So you have boundary value problems in spherical coordinates. So do you know what the y's are?
Spherical harmonics, exactly, yeah. Yeah. So wait, what is y2-0?
That's
It's also a Legendre polynomial, yeah. So it's 3 cosine square theta minus 1. It's and theta would be then the angle with respect to this z-axis here. And then the y22 and y20, they are sine square theta cosine 2 phi and sine square theta sine 2 phi, combinations of these two. This is e to the I 2 phi, and this would be the e to the minus I 2 phi. So these are actually very simple trigonometric formulae actually representing or reflecting the orientation of this. I mean, the simplest are the Legendre polynomials of, or are the spherical harmonics of first rank, so the y10, because they're exactly identical to the vectors. Yeah. For example, a z vector is cosine theta, an x vector is sine theta cosine phi, and a y vector would be sine theta sine phi. Yeah. So they're very simple functions in the, well, in every textbook. So, okay, so yeah, now you know that. Let's continue. okay, I mentioned already these walls. So, I mean, we can introduce an alignment tensor by these walls here, and then if we have an if we have a vector between two nuclei, then we have a dipolar coupling, which is given here. Here you see the formula. This would be the 3 cosine square theta minus 1. And here then the combination of y22 and y2 minus 2 would be sine square theta cosine 2 phi. And so we have both angles, the theta angle, the azimuthal angle, sorry, the projection angle as well as the azimuthal angle. They contribute to the dipolar coupling. And by that, one can measure the orientation of a vector with respect to this alignment tensor. And one can nicely measure this dipolar coupling, for example, between a nitrogen and a proton by taking an isotropic reference experiment in which one measures the, there's also the coupling through the bond. This would be the J coupling, which one can see here, 93.38 hertz. And then the anisotropic coupling, if one puts this then into an alignment medium, here one sees that the coupling has changed to 96.97 hertz. So the difference between the two is about 3.6 hertz, and this 3.6 hertz would be then the dipolar coupling, which reflects the orientation of this vector. Now, I was talking not only about orientation, but also modulation or distribution of orientation. So how does this come into play? Well, some of you may have flown here, and in most of the planes these days you have these video screens, and if you type map, for example, I was flying here to Tom, with Tom, then you see the Earth. Here you see the Earth. South Pole always indicates, of course, that the South Pole is the largest continent in the world. India looks like Scandinavia or like Sweden. Yeah, it's just clear, because I mean everything that is closer to the poles becomes larger in the x direction by this projection. Of course, I mean here you see the North Pole is just a point, but here it becomes as large as it can ever be. So this is the projection which we can also use. And for example, if we use this distribution here, actually this is from MD. This is a distribution of orientations of this vector onto this projection here. Then it would look like this. I mean, not exactly identical, but almost. And so the question is: can we actually measure such distributions experimentally? Can we see those distributions? And this is indeed the case if we use different tensors. Now, let's assume we have such a tensor here, and we measure a certain value for the dipolar coupling, and then this means that if we have this tensor here, that certain theta and phi angles are possible. So we measure, for example, that for a certain dipolar coupling which has a certain value, there's of course because we have two angles, namely theta and phi, there must be a distribution of theta and phi values which fulfill this dipolar coupling. This must be like this, because we have a formula. If we go back here, you see it here, we have this formula where a single value is reflected by
one theta and one phi value, so there must be a line which gives an, or if you want, an isodipolar coupling line in this plane, which is shown here. So from this, we don't have any dynamics. It just means that this dipolar coupling can be fulfilled by all these different orientations. But now we can do another alignment. So there are many, many different possibilities of aligning a molecule in solution. And let's take another one. So let's take, for example, this one here. And then, of course, the possibilities look different. Here now, for example, we have such a circle. Now it's clear that there are only 2 points left, 0, 90 on the equator, or this one here, theta equals 90 and theta equals 180. And we can complement that, for example, here another one, here another one, here another one. And so finally we see, okay, where do all these five lines cross? They cross is just in one single point. So we have, we are able to define the point for measuring at least in, actually one can show for this rank two tensor interactions in five different alignment media, one is able to directly identify where a vector lies. So one is able to define the orientation of this. It's nothing else than, for example, trying to measure the vector. Let's look, for example, here we have a glass. It has a certain length and it has a certain orientation. Let's assume now the glass is just a line like this one here. How would I do that? If the only possibility that I have is parallel light is nothing else than making projections. So I could, for example, shine my parallel light along the x-axis, along the y-axis, and along the z-axis. And from these projections, just with Pythagoras, I put together the length of this glass here. It's nothing else than what we are doing here. We are making projections. We are making projections not in three-dimensional space, but in five-dimensional space, because these tensors actually are five-dimensional objects because of this rank two property that the tensors have. Now, if we go a little bit closer here, then we see, okay, all these lines cross in a point. And if they all cross in the same point, then we know this vector must be static. However, if they do not cross in the same point, as is shown here, if we have a distribution of orientations, then the lines will not cross in this point. And this is due to the fact that the length of the vector is then by a variation, if you make a projection of something that is varying, then the projections don't add up to the unit length of the vector. So, for example, if we take all these glasses here, and we throw them into the lecture hall and we try to find out where they are, and one of them is still oscillating or so, then in this projection procedure, it will look shorter. So by measuring the length of the vector, we are able to know whether it's moving or not. And actually, this can be, I've shown that graphically to you in these plots, but this can also be just cast into equations. And the equations are very simple. I mean, here we have the dipolar coupling reflected here by these spherical harmonics, and here we have now cast it into the molecular frame, and then we have a sum over all the five spherical harmonics here from minus two to plus two. We have a matrix in front, this FIM, which is the alignment tensor expressed in the molecular frame. And in order to know what the distribution of the vectors is, what we can do is just to invert this linear equation. It's nothing else than a linear equation. When can we invert this? Well, if this F matrix is linearly independent, then we can invert it, and then we are here, and we are able to know what these spherical harmonics, average spherical harmonics are. So we invert this equation, and then we are here. And actually, the definition of the order parameter is nothing else than taking these spherical harmonics, the absolute value of these spherical harmonics to the square, which is nothing else than this here, and summing over all the five absolute values to the square, and then we are here where we have the order parameter derived from these residual dipolar couplings.
And with this, we are able to measure then the variability, the distribution of these vectors.
Now, when we look the RDCs, the residual dipolar couplings, they are averaged over all these time ranges here, while there's another definition of an order parameter, which is derived from parameters which depend only up to the correlation time. The correlation time is the rotational diffusion time that governs the diffusion of the molecule. Then one sees one is covering only this time range here. So by taking the ratio between the residual dipolar coupling RDC order parameters and this so-called Lipari-Chabot order parameter, actually this was done by colleagues of Ruth at NIH, Lipari and Chabot, they invented this order parameter here in the 80s. Then one can get out what type or how much motion actually is going on in this range here beyond the correlation time of the molecule. Now, here's just a collection of the data sets that we use. Maybe this is not so interesting. And what one sees is that if one compares here with the Lipari-Chabot order parameters, which are the ones that go up to the correlation time, and if one compares them with the RDC-derived order parameters, then the RDC-derived order parameters are smaller in size. And this is also summarized here, maybe in a slightly different representation. Here we have the Lipari-Chabot order parameters, which go for the sub-tau c, with a fast motion, faster than the correlation time of ubiquitin, which is about 4 nanoseconds. And then here we take this ratio, RDC-derived order parameters divided by the Lipari-Chabot order parameters, and then one sees this distribution here of motion, which is then taking place in this time range here between nanoseconds and milliseconds. And since there's not much going on actually in the in this time range here, in this microsecond to millisecond time range, then one knows most of this motion that is depicted in these order parameters must be here. Now, of course, this might be a little bit dry. And some of you are starting sleeping and so on. And it may be due to the dinner yesterday. It may be due to many other things. Maybe that is not really your interest or so. But it's a very biophysical investigation, of course. But the question is, I mean, now that one knows how these distributions of vector orientations actually go along the molecule, would it not be possible actually to recast that into a structure? Because, I mean, we know now, okay, we have motion here on the sub-tau c timescale, we have motion on the super-tau c timescale, so would it be possible actually to translate that into an ensemble? And that's exactly what we did, and of course here I just give you the history of the ensembles in principle that one knows for ubiquitin structure. So, of course, it has been crystallized. There's a crystal structure, 1UBQ, which does not have any dynamics. It was recorded at a nitrogen temperature, very physiological temperature. It was recorded in a crystal, very physiological situation of a protein to be in a crystal. And so the RMSD is also zero. Yeah, there's no motion cast into this structure. Now, Ed Bex, a colleague from NIH, took NOEs. I mentioned those NOEs, nuclear Oberhauser effect, to measure distances in addition to the residual dipolar couplings, and tried to define the best average structure of the molecule, which is recast here. One sees that the C-terminus, actually, which is not seen in the X-ray structure because it's so mobile, is now also seen here, and the NMR structure is also mobile here. However, for the core of the molecule, excluding the C-terminus, which goes from amino acid 72 to 76, one sees that the RMSD is about 0.9 angstrom. So dynamics is not really included here because it's just about the average structure. But you see the RMSD is already going up. Then Chris Dobson and Michele Vendruscolo from Cambridge, UK, they tried to include the Lipari-Chabot order parameters in addition to NOEs So they try to make an ensemble which also reflects the motion in the sub-tau c time scale, so the fast motion faster than the correlation time. And they arrived at an ensemble with a width of about 0.56 or 0.51 angstrom. And then finally, we made together with Berthe Groth and Xavier Salvatella from Barcelona, Berthe Groth also in Göttingen, we made another ensemble here for NOE and RDCs. And these ensembles are shown here. They take into account sub-tau c and also supra-tau c motion. And depending a little bit on how one calculates them, they have an RMSD of 0.83. This would be the widest one, which is still in agreement with the measurement data, to 0.57, which is very similar to the Vendruscolo-Dobson ensemble, or 0.5. And these ensembles actually... these ensembles are not, like in many, many cases, of course, when NMR structures have been published, are not a reflection of the ignorance about the structure, but they are actually, these ensembles fulfill the massive amount of experimental data better than a single structure here. So if we take this structure here, then the agreement with the experimental data is worse than if we allow the molecule actually to adopt various conformations. So we prove here that we have more than one conformation in solution. It's not just a single conformation, but an ensemble reflects the situation better than a single structure. And of course, for that one needs many, many parameters, more parameters than if one wants just to calculate an average structure. Now, does one learn anything from this ensemble of structures here? And what we did at the time with this ensemble was actually to cast this into five principal component modes. And two of these principal component modes are shown here. Actually, five modes are sufficient to capture 95% of the motion of the molecule. And the largest two principal components are shown here. And what one sees is that in red is the solution ensemble, and in black triangles now are the structures that ubiquitin adopts when it binds to a recognition protein. So this is exactly the situation that Ruth was discussing yesterday. You have a molecule that binds to several other molecules, and how does it do that? I mean, how does it use, for example, the interfaces? And there, of course, one can use a structure, or the question is, I mean, do these structures actually differ from each other? And there one sees that clearly ubiquitin, when it binds different molecules here, this would be the black triangles, it adopts different structures when it binds these different recognition partners. However, in the solution, all these structures are there already. Because, I mean, all the structures that ubiquitin adopts when it binds a binding partner are there in solution already. There's no adaptation of the molecule to its recognition partner. The structures are there already. They do not have to be adapted. We don't need induced fit in order to bind. The structures are there already. They are natively there. So the native structure of the molecule is an ensemble. It's not a structure that then adapts and changes when it binds. At least it does not have to, because the structures are all there already in solution. One can also cast this into a movie if we walk along the largest principal component, one sees here that this loop is moving, and depending on what the loop position is, it can either bind the yellow molecule here, or then if the loop has changed and also other parts in the molecule change, then it binds the green molecule here. Now, of course, the question is, or what is the time scale of interconversion between these different conformations? I mean, first of all, of course, I should remind you that this trajectory here is just an artificial trajectory, because we are just moving along this principal component. It does not mean that the molecule really moves like this. But it means that the molecule can adopt all these different conformations, but we don't know anything about the path. We know, and this is the knowledge from the crystal structures, we know that when it binds a molecule, that it adopts a certain conformation. For example, here it adopts a certain conformation when it binds the green one, and that conformation differs from the conformation that ubiquitin has when it binds the yellow protein. And clearly, the two kind of opposing ways of how molecules recognize each other is the induced fit, which was proposed in 59 by Koshland, in which the ensemble of free ubiquitin compared to the ensemble of the molecule when it binds recognition partners should look like this. Here it would be induced fit. It changes when it binds. This is clearly not the case. So we can exclude induced fit here. What we rather have is then what Monroe has introduced a few years later as so-called conformation selection, which the molecule adopts all the conformations already that it then needs in order to form the complex. And this would give a picture like this one, and this picture you also can see here. Now, yes?
When
we published this paper in 2008, there were just 46 structures. In the meantime, more structures have been generated, and we are constantly looking whether they fall out of the ensemble. But it wouldn't be not surprising if regions in the plot, for example, here or so, would be found. Another thing, of course, is that one can try to restrict the conformational ensemble to a smaller one and then see that binding to certain binding partners is abolished. And that is also the case. So colleagues from Genentech, actually, they have done ubiquitin mutations not in the binding site but somewhere in the hydrophobic core of the molecule, which is not involved in the binding. So it's more this allostery principle that Ruth was mentioning yesterday as well. And that then restricts the conformational freedom of this molecule here. And then indeed what they see is that the binding to certain binding partners is abolished or is at least reduced quite dramatically. So of course there are implications for drug design, because one could say, let's, for example, enhance a certain conformation that maybe another molecule which is similar to this one here, for example, in SH2 domains or so. This has always been a big problem because they bind to everything, or kinases and so on. Why not try to make binders which do not bind to the ground state, but more, or to the, I shouldn't say ground state, to the average conformation, but more to something that is on the edge, yeah? Because then maybe the selectivity is higher. Yeah? So that is something which could come out of this type of research. Now, I don't know how long, I did not get any sign yet to stop, so I just got it. 20 minutes? Great. Okay, so here you see these arrows, and here you see these arrows as well. Now, I mentioned that we are, of course, interested in looking how fast is the interconversion between these different timescales. And I did not really mention, but, could go back, but... The problem with NMR is that in this region between about 4 nanoseconds and 50 microseconds, it cannot measure timescales easily, because there's no kinetic information that NMR can derive there. So we resorted to another technique. I don't know whether you have ever heard about dielectric relaxation spectroscopy. Who has heard about this? So Jason has heard about it, but okay, so we have two, but not the students, so I can give you an introduction to this. In principle, it's a very simple bulk method. And this method actually uses the following, that if a molecule has an electric dipole, and many molecules have, small molecules, but also proteins, and you have an electrical field, that you apply along the solution, for example, of these molecules, So they have a static dipole. Without a field, of course, they are randomly distributed. But with a field,
they will align.
And if the field changes, then they will align in the opposite direction. Now, they can only align if the rotational correlation time of the molecule is faster than the change of the electrical field. So if the electrical field changes, for example, in the case of ubiquity, we have 4 nanoseconds is the correlation time. But if we change the electrical field every picosecond, for example, then these molecules will have no time to follow. So such an electrical field will go through without any energy loss. However, if the electrical field changes slower than 4 nanoseconds, for example, 10 nanoseconds, then, of course, the molecules can follow, and energy is absorbed from this electrical field by these electrical dipoles. And this is used, for example, to measure the correlation time of molecules that are in solution. The correlation time now, the correlation time is defined by the diffusion constant together with actually the observable. The observable here is an electrical dipole. This has rank 1, so L is actually 1. If we measure, for example, with NMR the correlation time, then we do it from magnetic dipolar interactions, which has a rank 2. So the correlation times that one is extracting from dielectric relaxation spectroscopy and from NMR spectroscopy are different. In the case of L equals 1, we have here 1 times 1 plus 1 is 2. However, in the case of magnetic interactions, we have 2 times 2 plus 1 is 6. So there's a factor of 3 between the correlation times that are extracted from dielectric relaxation spectroscopy and from magnetic resonance. And this is nicely shown here, so one can measure this. I mean, actually, there's also the water peak here at 7 picoseconds. This is the rotational correlation time of the water. Of course, there's water in the solution, and water has a dipole. Of course, you pick it up. But then we have here at 12 nanoseconds, we have the correlation time of the molecule, which is smack on the correlation time that we measure with NMR. If we take this factor of 3 into account, 12 divided by 3 is 4. That's exactly the correlation time I was mentioning before. But one just has to remember that it is dependent on which observable one is looking at. And then we see, in addition, something here, which is at about 900 nanoseconds. And this bump actually was observed in this study here for the first time. It was not a study we did, but experts in dielectric relaxation spectroscopy did this after we sent them the molecule. It has to be salt-free and at a high concentration and so on. One has to deduct the H2O conductivity and so on. And it was a complete surprise that one sees this peak. And then the big problem was, why is it there at all? Because conventional dielectric relaxation spectroscopy was actually excluding it. So first we had to derive a theory, actually not we, but then Rainer Kree at the University of Göttingen, who is an expert in theory of soft matter. And the model is the following. Let's assume we have a molecule which has a static dipole and another dipole, which actually can adopt either the same orientation as the static one or the antiparallel orientation. And of course, this could be different conformations. Now, if we have two conformations in a molecule, then we could have, for example, that the electric dipole varies. And the simplest assumption would be that it varies between two values. One value is large, the other value is small. And we assume that the interconversion between these two situations, the rate actually is gamma. So we have this interconversion rate here between the two conformations. Now, how can we pick this up, this process? Actually, there is, of course, in the solution, you will also, in addition to the molecule, which might be here ubiquitin, you will also have ions. Despite the fact that it's salt-free, I mean, one has at least to discharge the charges of the molecule, the surface charges of the molecule. So there will be a little bit of salt, and we have calculated the salt concentration is of the order of maybe three times as large as the ubiquitin concentration. And now comes another assumption. The other assumption is that if we have a smaller dipole in our molecule, for example, in this conformation, then less ions will attach to the molecule, while if we have a larger dipole, more ions will attach to the molecule. This also makes a lot of sense because, I mean, ions look or associate with charged particles, and here we have a charged particle, and here we have a charged particle. But in this case here, the charge, in this case here, the charge is more, and therefore more molecules, more ions attached to it. Now, of course, we have also the other ions because the ion concentration, of course, does not change if we are in this situation here or in this situation. It's just that the number of mobile ions is changing. Here we have three, assuming a certain concentration of the ions, we have three mobile cations and three mobile anions, while in this situation we have only one positive and one negative mobile ion. Now, what does this mean? It means that the conformational fluctuation of the molecule here, irrespective of the orientation with respect to the electrical field, because the orientation changes, of course, much faster with the electrical field because we are now looking at a process that is slower than the correlation time, but still the ion mobility, which is a DC current, is modulated by these dissolved molecules here. And this can be recast in formulae, and one then gets a modulation here of the dielectric observable, which depends on the correlation exchange rate between these two conformations here. And what then is predicted that in addition to the normal correlation time induced dielectric bump, you get another one at 2 gamma. In this case here, we assume equal population, so it's gamma plus gamma, so the two rates are just added up. And so what we think is that this peak here at 900 nanoseconds is coming from such a process in which the conformations average with a time scale of about 900 nanoseconds. Now, of course, the question is, are these conformations the conformations that we have described before in our ensemble or not? And this can also be investigated this should be also here, but it's not. So actually, one can look at the ratio of this peak here with respect to this peak here, and one can, of course, look also at the ensemble, and then with appropriate calculation of how many ions will attach to this or these conformations, and we have many, many conformations, one gets out that even quantitatively the size of this peak compared to this peak here, to the normal correlation time peak, is correct. Yeah, so one relates now an NMR-derived ensemble with the bulk property of modulating the ion current and gets out that quantitatively this fits. Now, we can now go back and look at relaxation dispersion. And actually, this is probably then the more or less the last thing, well, maybe not exactly the last, but relaxation dispersion is another, I was talking about dielectric relaxation, now it's relaxation dispersion. That's another way of measuring motion with NMR spectroscopy. And I show you a little bit how that goes. As you can see here, we are going to minus 8 degrees. And why minus 8? Well, if we go, we can, of course, look also at ubiquitin in a powder and go from 307 all the way down to lower temperatures. And we see at 264 Kelvin, which would be minus 9 degrees, we are in a range of about 50 microseconds for the motion. That was at 307 Kelvin, 900 nanoseconds. So we can slow down the process, and this means that we just have to measure in solution now at minus 8 degrees and then find out whether we pick up this motion with NMR. Now, normally one cannot measure at low temperature,
lower than 0 degrees, because normally then the water becomes ice and it's not a solution anymore. However, if one puts the sample into capillaries, which are about less than 1 millimeter in diameter, then one can easily reach minus 13 degrees or so without any problem with of ice formation, and so one can cool down samples. I think the lowest was minus 15 or so that we reached. Here, this is from the literature, minus 13, and this is our measurements here at minus 8 degrees. And one sees then that we get a motion here in the time range of about 122 microseconds. Now, how is this done, this relaxation dispersion? It's another way of measuring kinetics. And this is due to the fact that if we have different conformations, for example, one conformation here, another conformation here, the chemical environment is different, and therefore the chemical shifts are different. And if we have slow exchange, of course, we can pick up the two resonances here individually, but if we have fast exchange, we get a single line, which is at the average of the two chemical shifts, omega 1 plus omega 2 divided by 2. But then the line width, measured here in the as the size of this line, reflects the difference between the chemical shifts here, delta omega, to the square, and also, and this is the kinetic information, the lifetime of each of these conformations. And this would be the formula that comes out, the average, the fast exchange, in the fast exchange limit, the line width is governed by the rate, tau L, or the lifetime, or the inverse rate, and delta omega square. Delta omega square would be the chemical shifts of the different conformations here. And actually, one can measure this because, of course, here we have a product, so it's very difficult to distinguish the two. We don't know delta omega, and we don't know the lifetime, but one can make this formula here, augment this formula, actually, by manipulating in the experiment the difference in the frequencies, and this is then called relaxation dispersion. What one does is that one applies a field with a strength called omega 1, and then this formula becomes a little bit more complicated. Here now it becomes a dispersion curve. Yeah, here we have in the denominator now this 1 plus omega 1 tau L square. So by varying the field strength, by varying the size of this additional field, we are able then to extract tau L, and if we have tau L, we can also extract delta omega. So this is a way of measuring kinetics. It works in a time range of about down to about 50 microseconds and can be used in order to derive the kinetics of pretty fast conformation interconversions. Now, I showed you that we can do this here. These relaxation dispersion curves then look like this. One can nicely see here at minus 8 degrees, one has 122 microseconds. Or here at minus 13, one has 133 microseconds for two residues, valine 70 and isoleucine 13. These are two residues in the
ubiquity. Now, just putting this together, what we do is we do this temperature dependence dielectric relaxation. We measure, we go down in the powder to indicate that we are in the relaxation dispersion limit here at 50 microseconds at minus 8 degrees. And then we measure this relaxation dispersion. And indeed, and we can do this temperature dependent, and then we can extrapolate and come up with a number here between 1 and 19 microseconds of this super tau C motion taking place in this region here between 4 nanoseconds and 50 microseconds. So in principle, a time range of 4 orders of magnitude, 4 nanoseconds to 50 microseconds would be 4 orders of magnitude, is then reduced to about 1 order of magnitude. So we know now we have this type of motion going on here in this 19 microseconds at 35 degrees. Not fast, not slower, and
also not faster. Now the question, of course, is again reality check. I mean, all these methods have not been applied for this before, So as I mentioned before, for the MD people, where one has to look, is it really true? One also has to see, is there further evidence from other methods that show that this could be true? And there is indeed evidence. Actually, now this comes from MD. Yeah? So MD did completely independently. They did also long dynamics. And the longest, I mean, the best computer that people have at the moment is Anton, which is sits in New York, has been built by D.E. Shaw, who was a professor for economics, I think, somewhere on the West Coast. Computer science, okay, on the West Coast. And he invented algorithms with which it was possible to predict very well the courses or the value of shares. And so he made so much money with these that probably, I don't know how much, billions or something like that, that he said, okay, now I want to fulfill my dream. I want to do molecular dynamics. And I go to a company who builds for me the fastest computer, adapted only to MD. So really a crazy guy. And then he collected in the world very nice talents, which would work for him. And so he was able, and this was published first on BPTI. It's not the same molecule as the one that we are looking at here, ubiquitin. On BPTI in 2010, he published a trajectory up to 1 millisecond. And normally, I mean, with normal computers, people are still struggling going up to about 1 microsecond or so. So he's going to 1 millisecond. Of course, he wants to look at the folding problem and stuff like that. And so we thought, okay, now this is great that he has done this and nobody else can do it. Let's compare. And what one nicely sees is then here, this is a plot from his publication from 2010. Is this distribution here of motion in the backbone. And very nicely what one sees is here this bump in the backbone, this green line, which is translated is translated here. It should be green, but okay, it's red now here. 3 to 30 microseconds at 25 degrees, which is smack on the 1 to 19 microseconds at 35 degrees. So he reproduces exactly the same time scale that we see for the backbone in ubiquitin, he reproduces for BPTI. And from talks, I know that they have also done this on ubiquitin and they find exactly the same thing, also this 3 to 30 microseconds at 25 degrees. So this is really nice. But it's MD. And I mean, before I said, we want to do a reality check for MD, so I should not turn this argument around. So let's look, do we have something else? And so we are in the very comfortable situation of having at our institute also people that are interested in other experimental methodologies. And this is actually Simone Techert, who's working. She's an X-ray person. So she works at free electron lasers all over the world. She's traveling probably more than everybody else because half of the time she's spending at synchrotrons. And this is not counting the conferences that she is attending. And these people, they are really great. They have temperature jump free electron laser sex. So you make a temperature jump within a few picoseconds, really picoseconds. It's not nanoseconds, not microseconds, it's picoseconds. And then they look at how the sex curves change. And here, this is just a picture taken for the, I think it was the beta sheet region. Taken here, the time scale is nanoseconds. So this would be then, divided by 1,000 would be picoseconds. So this would be here 100 femtoseconds. This would be 1 nanosecond. This would be 100 nanoseconds. This would be 10 microseconds. And this would be 1 millisecond. So one can really record in real time. That's a real-time experiment because, of course, X-ray is an instantaneous observing methodology, one can observe how the molecule is moving. Yes. Now, what one sees here is, I mean, here in this fast time scale, the number of points is not so high, but what one sees here in the slower one is that there are regions in which the molecule is moving, also here, but there are other regions in which the molecule is not moving, for example, here. And so there, it's really interesting that with a single shot, you get out a fingerprint of dynamics and here the kinetic information of the molecule by just looking at the redistribution of the conformations with this instantaneous detection, which actually is sex. And if one looks here at the slow time scale, one sees that, I mean, they jump actually from minus 10 to 10 degrees. This is in order to not change the density of the water too much. And at 4, I mean, below 4, it increases. And above 4 degrees, it's also increasing. And that's why they jump in this region here. So here we have, if we look at this, we have 10 to 200 microseconds at 10 degrees. And again, this, if one extrapolates this according to these curves and also according to the Zax measurements, it's also again smack on here. Now, and the last one actually is, it's possible now also with some technical tricks to measure relaxation dispersion even down to 10 microseconds, and there we also see it here. This actually would be on protons now. One can go down to this region here, and we also extract here 10 microseconds. So in principle, with additional experimental as well as molecular dynamics, one can really say, I mean, something is happening in this time scale. Just to, as the last slides, how is this done? I mean, what these people do in this time-resolved WAX or NZAX experiments actually is that they shine a laser pulse with which they make this heating within about 10 picoseconds onto the sample, and then they observe with X-ray. They get three-dimensional plots because, of course, they can observe here the scattering, Q divided by Angstrom, and then they look at the change in the scatter amplitude. This would be this delta I of Q. And then, of course, they look here in the different time ranges. Now, what is really interesting, I think, is that the beta sheets, they are actually here in this region of about up to about 0.3 divided by Angstrom. The alpha helix is then beyond, and then comes the water, which is a big nuisance here. And what one sees nicely here is, for example, in the beta, this would be a beta sheet response, which takes place here at this time scale, which I was indicating up to about, I mean, here the peak is located at about 100 microseconds or so. And if one looks here in the alpha helix, one can also see the same peak. Now, this would be alpha helix response, beta sheet response, and one nicely sees it's not equally distributed over all the time scales. Similarly here, there's this hole, and there's this microsecond motion in both the alpha helix as well as the beta sheet. Now, for the Zax, what is clear is that if there was just a single amino acid changing or so, you would not see it as intensely as if the whole alpha helix is doing it or if the whole beta sheet is doing it, because you have repetitive distances in a beta sheet, you have repetitive distances in an alpha helix. So what one can also already see here, which is always difficult to prove in NMR spectroscopy, is that there's some correlation of the motion in the beta sheet as well as in the alpha helix. And the last part of the talk would have been on correlated motion detected with NMR spectroscopy, but maybe I can just show you a few pictures here. I was talking too slowly today, that's why all these pictures will not be shown. But correlated motion, actually, we have a method in NMR spectroscopy which can look at that, actually. This is then the last one. Maybe it makes you smile a little bit. In Germany, we are more famous for cars probably than for NMR, at least to the normal public. And there are these two brands that everybody wants to have. This is the BMW, and you see they have the wipers. The wipers here are like this, so the wipers go like this. They go like this. And of course, you can also say that these two are actually vectors in a molecule. For example, this could be an NH, and this could also be an NH. And actually, what one can do is measure the... I was talking about order parameters, but you can measure the order parameter not only of an individual vector, but also with respect to the angle that connects these two vectors. This is a so-called cross-correlated relaxation rate order parameter.
And in this case here, the order parameter, if you have a motion, if you have a motion like this, the cross-correlated order parameter is 1, because the angle does not vary between the two vectors, while the individual, the autocorrelated order parameter, is below 1. This is true for the BMW. Now, of course, we have the other brand, Mercedes. And you see, here the wipers go the other way. They go like this. They go anticorrelated. And in this case, of course, the angle between the two vectors is varying twice as much as for the individual ones. So again, if one is able to measure the cross-correlated relaxation order parameter with respect to the autocorrelated relaxation order parameter, it's possible to distinguish anticorrelatedness or cross-correlatedness. And this actually can be used in order to show how much correlated motion there is, and there is correlated motion, and with that I would like to end. Thank you very much.
Just thinking the limitations of NMR, that of course is the size. So, and particularly the measurements of resident RDCs is very interesting. But we, in the that work with amyloid, and so would like to do this mesh, for example, in oligomers and so forth. So, things that will average size will be around 200,000, 500,000. So do you forecast that in the future, maybe with now with the 1 giga or higher fields, maybe one can go do these measurements with such large things, eventually with fibrils and without going to the solid state? I mean, just thinking in solution or trying to combination with the bicells, and so.
Yeah, I mean, for example, for membrane proteins, it has been shown that RDCs can be measured. In principle, they can always be measured if you have a signal. And I mean, it's more the restriction to have, in general, a signal, because I mean, they can be extracted from, for example, very easily from either from NHs, I mean, those you anyway measure all the time, or from methyl groups. I did not mention this, but methyl groups also allow to measure these RDCs very, very nicely. And so whenever you get these signals, you can also measure RDCs.
So if you have the signal, and how about if you have the, for the larger proteins, if you have the X-ray structure, can you try to, sometimes you have the signal, but you don't have the assignment. So how is this crosstalk between X-ray?
Can be used. People are using RDCs and chemical shifts to calculate structures without NOEs anymore. So I mean these parameters can be used. RDCs have also been used for assignment. There are programs that do this. For example, my colleague Markus Zweckstetter is developing one of those MARS in which this is a feature that is implemented. I mean, RDCs can be used for many, many things. Also, for example, to look at homology between different proteins and so on. So they are widely usable, and they are pretty simple to measure. Sometimes it's more difficult to measure them. To measure correlation experiments or so in order to assign compared to RDCs, because they just require two-dimensional spectra, and so that can be used. I mean, with respect to fibrils or oligomers, I think that the technique should do what it can do. I mean, there's the the sensitivity is much lower still in solid state. On the other hand, the sensitivity becomes also low in liquid state if the size of the particle becomes too large. And it's not exactly clear where this limit actually is. I mean, if one goes for methyl group detection, which is very sensitive, it seems that there might, I mean, the sensitivity might be equal at about 1 megadalton or something like this. I mean, there's studies on proteasome
in which one compares the spectra recorded in solid state for the methyl groups compared to the liquid state for the methyl groups. And it seems that beyond a certain size, then it becomes better to record the solid state spectra. But I don't think one should, I will maybe show that also a little bit tomorrow. There's a lot of value in the combination between the two methodologies because in principle they are not doing, they have a lot of things in common. I mean, the strategy, for example, for assignment is more or less the same now these days. The strategy of looking at proton detection now also in solid state, I mean, just to increase this is very similar to what is done in liquid state. So in principle, one could just say that one should actually lower the wall between the two methods rather than increasing it. And we have, at my place, we have both. And it, I would say at least 30% or so of the projects that we have done would have never been possible unless the same people were working in the same house, being sometimes they don't talk to each other, but sometimes they do, and then it actually you can get insight that otherwise you would not get.
Hi, sorry, I'm not a physicist, so my question might be a little basic. But towards the beginning of your talk, I was wondering how much information can you get if I pick, say, a carbon alpha, how much information I can get from NMR regarding the relative influence of the protons or maybe the other atoms that are near versus the further away ones.
Understood. So how much is the chemical shift influenced by closer or farther away?
If I can have some kind of comparison of the energy of the interaction.
I mean, there are, most of the time, in principle, there's a hierarchy. I mean, the closer something is, and especially when it's bonded, the more, the bigger the influence on the chemical shift. And this goes maybe, certainly one bond, two bonds, even three bonds. For example, there's the famous so-called gamma effect. I mean, you have a carbon here, and you have another carbon, and another carbon. And then the question is, what is the dihedral angle? If it is 180, it's the chemical shift influence is different from if it is 60, and so on. So through the bonding network, I would say probably up to, at least three bonds, maybe four or five bonds. And this is, for example, taken care of when people measure so-called secondary chemical shifts. They do this by making a peptide with at least five amino acids in order to have this covalent connection of the measured nucleus to the other nuclei to take that into account. Now, there are more long-ranging effects also. For example, if you have a charge somewhere, then this also influences the chemical shift because you can imagine a charge is withdrawing or whatever, it's pulling away or pulling towards itself electrons. And electrons around the nucleus actually define its chemical shift. So if you have a charge somewhere and it need not be connected covalently to the nucleus that you are looking at, you will have an influence. Another influence which is also going through space is anisotropic interactions. Sometimes, for example, you have a phenyl ring. The phenyl ring, the magnetic field induces a ring current in it, and this ring current can change the chemical shifts. For example, I mean, there's a famous observation by Kurt Wüthrich, I think, very early on, I think it was BPTI, where one of the C-alphas normally are in a region between maybe 3.5 and 5.5 ppm resonated at, I think, 1.2 ppm. Yeah, so it was completely out of the range where it normally should be. Yeah. And why was this? Well, this was because there was a phenyl ring. I mean, here you have the H-alpha, say here. And there was a phenyl ring smack on this proton. And so it was extremely shielded due to this phenyl ring. Yeah. And so such situations occur that you have dramatic effects also through space, because this phenyl ring was, I don't know, probably 10, maybe even 20 or 30 amino acids away from this C-alpha. Actually, this tertiary structure influence of the chemical shift is used to calculate structures. Yeah, because, I mean, people measure the chemical shifts, assign them, and then they look which structure, for example, Rosetta proposes structures, and there are many possible solutions. These days, I think Rosetta makes structures within 2.5 angstroms or so, or some of them, or maybe only one of them, is 2.5 angstroms away from the real structure. But many others are much farther away. And so then it's valuable to pick that 2.5 angstrom away structure from the ensemble of structures that Rosetta proposes. And this can be done, as has been shown, at least for small size molecules, maybe up to 150 amino acids or so, it can be used, can be done with chemical shifts. Yeah, there's a CS Rosetta, I believe it's called, in which this chemical shift information is combined with Rosetta predictions, and from that one can get, I would say, structural models, which, I mean, 2.5 angstroms is still very far away. I mean, I once talked to a pharmaceutical chemist. He told me, if you don't know whether the ligand is within 0.5 angstroms to its real position, then it's not of a value. So 2.5 angstroms is quite a lot, but it's also better than nothing. And for structural genomics and whatever, I mean, all these techniques are used. Yeah.
Any other question? Another question. Thank you again.